Heroes Plus Ultra, the stars of our panel, Justin Briner, Colleen Clinkenbeard, Kellen Goff, Ricco Fajardo, and Justin Kerr! Oh my God. Yay! Oh my God, love you guys. Four hugs. Nice jacket. Okay, we're gonna take a quick group photo. Y'all are gonna be in it, okay? So are you guys ready? Stay standing, unless you don't wanna be seen and just like hide behind your friend. All right, you guys ready for this group photo? All right, you guys ready? You gonna get loud? Oh, I see some Promised Neverland cosplay right there. One more.
Yeah.
Who's excited? Me. Just a little bit. Okay, so, you guys, season four is so exciting.
Yeah.
Justin, I'm gonna start off with you. So, we got some reviews from Anime Expo. Everyone's saying these early episodes are darker and heavier than anything we've seen. All Might is out of commission. All eyes are on Deku. Okay, so what are we gonna see from him in season four? It has been a long journey for young Midoriya.
Yes, yeah, we've been rooting for him since the beginning. 60-some episodes already, and he's already gone through so much. It's amazing. This season is definitely a lot more intense, due in large part by his mentor, All Might, has passed the torch, so to speak, much sooner than I think any of them were expecting, and a little more urgently. So, gosh, we're going to see him grow and try his best to meet all these radical expectations that have just been dropped on him all of a sudden.
It's your turn.
Oh, okay.
Anybody?
No pressure.
Sorry. All right. Colleen, you're Momo.
I am.
Love her. Momo fans out there? Okay. You are also the director. So when I immediately found out I was interviewing you, I was like, I gotta ask her what has been her favorite moment of the series. And from a director's perspective, how did you get the message across that you wanted to? Because it's different.
That's interesting. It's so hard to pick a favorite moment. I have three, and the one off the top of my head is Todoroki versus Deku. When we
Good
first
one.
See Todoroki use his flame. I think just because that was one of the moments that really stuck in my head when I first watched it, like I got goosebumps, and then when I watched it again, I got goosebumps, and then when I watched it again, I got goosebumps. Yeah, so it was impactful. And as far as getting my message across, the show is so amazing. The show is so perfect in exactly what it is trying to do that I feel like a large part of my job is just to get out of everybody's way and make sure that the show gets to shine in the way that it shines. All of the voice actors get to do the same. The writers get to do the same. So my job is just to like kind of step out of the way and be like, you guys be great. And I think for messaging, I want you guys to know that we are going to be really good shepherds of this brand. We want you to get My Hero Academia as it is coming out in Japan and have the same feeling that they have as they're watching it in Japan. I want that to be completely across the board the same. So that's my goal, that you guys get those moments.
Yeah.
Okay, Justin Cook, you're in the hot seat now. So literally, I ran up to Justin behind the curtain, and I was like, oh my God, Justin, the scene with Kirishima, he had this like big shiny moment. It was one of my favorite moments in My Hero Academia, and I was like crying, and he was like, it's okay, calm down. I was like, so you all know which scene I'm talking about, right? Like he has his shining moment in season three, right? So talk to me about when you read that scene, and what did you want the audience to take away from it? Because I told you, I was feeling like 1,000 emotions.
You,
I was a little excited.
No, absolutely. And the thing I think in that scene is that all of these characters have to get beyond themselves. And we've spent the whole three seasons so far watching everybody, Deku warm up, and they're fighting, they're getting stronger. But I felt like this was the first time that they had to actually get past a mental block, as it were, to get to, whether it was Kirishima or whether Deku or Bakugo himself. So I thought that was the coolest thing. And for me, I think all of us get to see parts of ourselves and all of these characters as we watch it. And So the thing I would say, I think what I got out of it was, don't let myself get in my own way.
I'm sorry, when Kirishima reaches out to Bakugo, I'm just like, Deku has to put his pride aside, Kirishima's got to step up to the plate, and like, Bakugo's just like, there's my point, there's my best friend. Like, literally, I was like, eyes watering. I've cried so many times watching this anime. Y'all with me on that, or am I just a big Deku crybaby over here? Okay. All right, guess who we're going to put in the hot seat? The new guys.
Just a couple of rookies. A couple of noobs.
Just a couple dudes being dudes.
Couple dudes.
Okay, so, Kellen, what happened to that styling jacket of yours? It's a little hot up here, though, I guess.
Yeah, no, the heat beams are sort of coming down.
The heat beams, yeah.
Right,
oh, well, we're going to put the pressure on now because I got some hard questions for you guys.
Okay.
Okay, ready? All right, so y'all play already iconic characters, in my opinion, Mirio Overhaul. Number one, did you scream when you found out you got the role? And then two, how does it feel to be a part of this epic anime? I can only imagine.
You go first, man.
No, I insist.
Oh, rock, paper, scissors.
Thank you, rock, paper, scissors. Yeah, I did not scream at first because I didn't know the audition. But it was an interesting thing because I auditioned for, if I can say this, Colleen, I auditioned for both Mirio and Overhaul.
Oh.
And so I did a bad, bad, bad guy voice, and then I did good, good, good guy voice. And I wasn't sure like what was going to happen, but then Colleen said, hey, you should read about this guy named Mirio. I'm like, cool. Well, I'm still watching, as we all are, watching a bunch of different animes. I'm like, I still need to catch up on the new My Hero. And I quickly grabbed a hold of all the manga I could, and the moment that did rupture me, as we all weep during this show, I was in a bakery, 85 Degrees Bakery in Carrollton, Texas, and I had this manga with my boy on the front, Mirio, and I just like started openly weeping. No spoilers. It's just great. I'm just so excited, you guys. Season 4 is gonna be rad. So anyway, yeah, that's I didn't scream. I wept with joy.
Aww. What about you, Kellen? Was there a scream?
Well, yeah. For short. When I was auditioning for Overhaul, I was coming off of a bad case of bronchitis. So the voice was already, you know, kind of scratchy. I was doing my best to make it as smooth as I could, and it took 6 hours to get a clip that didn't have my voice cracking like a little boy in it. I auditioned originally for Overhaul and Sun Eater, Tamaki, so who is played by the lovely, lovely Aaron Dismuke, who is back in Texas right now. We love you, Aaron.
But he
originally, Overhaul was going to sound way different. He was going to sound more gruff if I had, you know, done it on the first take, but I auditioned with what would become Overhaul's voice for Tamaki, and Colleen, the genius that she is, said, how about you reread it, but with the voice that you used for Tamaki? I'm like, yeah, okay.
Schematics.
And I tried it, and it worked, and I sent it off, and then the rest is history. But when I found out, it was so unceremonious. I just found out, like, hey, so we'd like to bring you in as Overhaul. I'm like, where's Ashton? but sure enough, I messaged you on Twitter. You're like, yep. And I'm like,
wasn't joking.
I was a huge fan, still am, of anime and My Hero Academia before I got cast. So to be part of it is, it's a dream come true, and I have to thank you for that.
They're going to make me cry again, and we ain't even watching the anime right now. All right, so my second question for you guys is, you look at Mirio, I think, aw, happy. You look at Overhaul, I get a little scared. I want to know, what was your initial reaction when you first saw your character, and what did you immediately think, this is what I want to convey about this character?
Well, you know, they say that the soul is in the eyes. And when you look deeply into the eyes of Mirio, those deep blue eyes, it's just a vacuous sea of sky blue. And I think the thing about it, I was like, who is this, like, Pit Boy, like, Vault Boy, you know what I mean? Lucas looking Tintin. I don't know what you are, but you jacked. You also jacked.
You listed all of them.
Yeah, like, they're all, anyway, yeah, but there's a sweetness to him and an excitement. Of course, he's strikingly bears a resemblance to All Might. Like in sort of like his hairstyles, you know, like a lot of the of students like to emulate their number one hero. I was stricken with how sweet he was in all the text. Not just his look, like the second I saw his first panel, you know, trash. hey, bro, what's up, man? yes. So when I first saw him, I was like, oh, man, that guy's really strong. He's got abs.
Really strong. Yeah. The first thing that ever came to mind when I saw him was I really like that coat. So I got my own. I really, really identify with him, not for the, you know, bad reasons, but that he has so much drive to go towards his goal. So as I started reading more and more on him, I started to look past the horrible things that he does just for a second, just to see, if there's anything redeemable there. And he has drive, for better or worse, he has drive. When I first saw him, I thought, oh, yeah, this is something I can definitely sink into, because I'm known for the creepy stuff. If you guys know Five Nights at Freddy's, I was Freddy in that. So coming off of that, thank you. Coming off of that into this, I'm like, okay, so I can subdue this a bit. Try something that's not screaming for the first time yet.
and then you saw anime. Yeah. Now he's screaming.
Yeah, right. Knock on wood.
Aww. Okay, I'm going to bring it back to Justin. So season three, massive moments with Deku. I mean, he basically orchestrated Bakugo's escape, has a heart-wrenching battle against Bakugo. One of my favorite parts of this anime is that rivalry / friendship between them. Can you elaborate on what sets it apart?
Yeah, gosh, it's so complex. It's so dynamic. I feel like a lot of your classic rivalries are these two strong folks who are just constantly trying to get stronger. They often go their separate ways and reconvene and try again, and who's the strongest this time, etc. So for Deku and Bakugo, they have such a lifetime of strife to go through. They started as friends, then he became a bully, and it just seems very believable to me. Like, they, as two rivals, they are going to school together and training together all the time, so they are constantly pushing each other to become better, become stronger in maybe not the most healthy of ways. So Bakugo inspires Deku to become more sure-footed and become a little tougher in his resolve. And meanwhile, Deku, I think, inspires Bakugo to look at what is good in the people around him and try to capitalize on that in his own way. So it's just really intriguing and kind of beautiful to watch these two kids grow up before our eyes and to be able to root for one or both of them and see, hopefully, see them start to work together a little more in the future.
Was that an amazing answer or what? Like, I literally was just, like, listening so intently. I was like, yes, man, yes, you're speaking to my soul right now. Oh, my gosh. Okay, so that is one of my favorite rivalries. Goku and Vegeta, who? Just kidding. I'm a Dragon Ball fan, too. I'm just kidding. I'm just playing here. Okay, Colleen. So I literally, I mean, I told you I cried a lot, but I cried when Bakugo and Deku were facing off. There's so many great battles, All For One versus All Might. What has stuck out to me with this anime is that the fights they're just powerful emotionally. Would you agree with that?
I absolutely. Emotionally and psychologically, you're very invested in every matchup that you see. And I mean, honestly, that goes for not just the fights, but for any scene where you're getting any kind of depth. I think the main function of that is that they're so three-dimensional. The entire story is very three-dimensional, and every character has a backstory, and you understand their motivation from the beginning. And if you don't, then you're just waiting to find it because you know you will. And so I think that when you see the matchup between two characters, it's not like you're just seeing them throw down. You are seeing them come together as two fully fledged human beings and try to figure out how are they going to mess with each other psychologically? Maybe they trying to help each other psychologically? and it puts so much more investment from the audience in every scene. And so, in particular, those two fights that you mentioned, I think, and the Todoroki one that I mentioned before, that you really get, I know where all of you are coming from. I don't even know whose side I'm on right now. I just want to see how this is going to play out because I believe you and I believe what you're going through.
I think with All For One versus All Might, I remember when I first started watching it, I was like, all right, here's the big bad versus the big good, you know? But then you saw how All For One was messing with him, and he was bringing up Nana and his past, and I was just like, I have never seen something like this before. And I got in a big fight with one of my coworkers about Bakugo. He was like, Bakugo, he's just mean, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, there's something beneath it, man. Like, what's going on? Like, we got to, like, figure that out. And that fight that we were talking about spoke volumes. You know, we really saw all the pain that he was dealing with and insecurity. So I'm sorry.
And both actors, the original Japanese actor and our dub actor Clifford Chapin, did such an amazing job with that scene. Like, just made you cry every time. I cry all the time when they're in the booth.
I'm glad I'm not alone, Colleen. Thank you. Okay, Justin, I'm going to bring it back to you. So I thought it'd be fun if we went down the line and y'all just talked about why you love your character. Because
well,
we know you love them, but like just deep dive here. What's so special about Kirishima?
He cares. I want to get a T-shirt that says Kirishima cares. Oh. I feel like that's the thing that I think I like the most about him is that, he seems to be openly accepting of anybody and everybody. He seems to always encourage. These are the things that that I would like to, like, if I was able to describe myself, those would be the things I'd like to be able to say. So I guess I love him for that and look up to him for that.
Ricco? Aww. You're in the hot seat. Yeah, you gotta follow that up, Ricco.
Listen, I love him. Sorry. Kirishima cares,
trash,
guys.
Am I right?
Something we all get to share. I can say this confidently that for those of you that don't know, you know, read ahead and all that stuff, I've fallen in love with this character, and I've been voicing anime for a long time, and to have a character as noble, sweet, and never say die, never quit, is very humbling and also very encouraging to represent a character like that in the shows. Those are my favorite kind of underdoggy sort of characters. But also, like, something I've been meditating about with Mirio, no spoilers, he has a permeation quirk that lets him, like, phase into things. You saw it in the game. Anyway, so, like, he can phase through stuff. He has this thing where when he goes into the darkness, he can't breathe, he can't see. He, like, goes. And to me, I was like, man, that sounds a lot like depression. And I was like, oh, man. I'm like, what if this is a big metaphor for, like, falling into depression and you're alone and you're by yourself. But what's most important is about, and if you go too far, you die, right? But if you come out, you can come out in any way that you see fit. So constantly, and doing it every single time, it like hurts, right? He's covered in scars, his body's just like, everyone says your quirk is lame, it sucks, don't even bother using it. He practiced, and Sir Night Eye believes in him, and he's like, okay, and he goes down this road, and he makes it something worthwhile. Not only that, to the point where people think he's the best. Okay, so
Colleen,
no spoilers, no spoilers.
And that's why Colleen's
that's
here.
That's why she's here. Anyway, what I mean to say is, is there is something about not quitting. That's what I mean to say. And this character is one who doesn't. So, yeah.
Who just got the feels on that one, right? All right, Kellen. Sorry, you had two really good answers to follow up.
Yeah, and you know, I admire some things about Overhaul, but unfortunately they're spoilers, so I can't really answer this.
He's
to
got
the
a cool
mask. Helen.
Yeah, no.
What did I don't
usually,
even I remember. I don't
you
remember.
You know what's funny? Usually I'm the Tom Holland here. I'm the one who likes spoils everything before it comes out, but I've learned. That said, am I allowed to talk about his quirk at all? No.
Yeah, she's brushing
okay,
her
well,
hair.
Well,
she's brushing her
okay,
hair. Don't
well,
do it.
Someone from Funimation's like, uh-uh, no.
Yeah, okay. Then I like his character design a lot.
man, that's hard to talk around, man.
I like that he has, you know, his boys, and there's a bit of loyalty and family about that, and he at least, you know, has, in whatever capacity, people who care about him, no matter what.
Quality save, man. Quality.
Thank you.
Yeah.
It would have been more quality if you hadn't said that.
I put put him on Front Street.
Go ahead, shake my hand, find out what happens.
Okay, no Justin, what do you like about Deku? What's so great about him?
What's there to like?
What's not to like? Oh, gosh. No, Deku is amazing. He's what really struck me about this character, especially starting out, was how he seems very much like a portrait of mental health growing up, and how I feel like folks struggle with their self-worth and people telling them that they can't achieve their dreams, or that they should temper their expectations and do something more realistic. And Deku grew up with all of that, those voices echoing through his head. So to see him come into his own so much and to make friends who lift him up and celebrate what makes him different is really amazing. And I think it's super special, especially for younger folks growing up, to have a character like that to root for and to see him succeed despite all the adversity.
Solid answer. Colleen, Momo, we love her.
This is going to be cliche, and I'm sorry, but it's still true, so I have to say it. I just think she's a great role model for young women. I think I think that she's struggling with something that a lot of young women struggle with, which is doubting themselves despite being awesome. And it will be really fun to watch her come into the realization that she is smart and she is talented and she is hardworking, like we all know. And I think it's important for people who are watching, especially young women, to be able to watch, but you know what, anybody, to be able to watch it and go, wait a minute, if somebody that awesome can doubt themselves that much and I believe it, then that must really be a real factor in the world. And maybe I am suffering from that, hey, am I awesome? And the answer is yes.
Probably, yeah.
Great answers, you guys. Okay, we only have a minute left. Last question. We'll go down the line really quickly, starting with Justin Cook. If you guys could play any hero or villain besides the character you play, who would you pick?
Oh, geez, that's always a tough one. Yeah. My trouble with that is that I enjoy everyone's performance so incredibly much that I would hate to deprive
like, I can't
the world
touch that.
Of that. Yeah,
I hear you. Okay, same answer for y'all? Or is there someone who you really want to play? Rico, okay.
Who do you want? Go. Who do you want to kick out?
Put the spotlight on it.
No one. I love all of you.
Ish.
But I like.
But.
Kaminari's cool.
Hey.
I love you, Kyle. You do an amazing job.
Dude, I would like to take a swing at like I hang out with Cliff all the time, but Bakugo, man, like I just like throwing that energy out there. I'm not sure I could maintain that amount of like bottled up rage.
You've done a pretty
the whole time.
You've done a pretty good job in Dr. Stone so far.
Yeah, I mean, that's like happy. Oh, thanks. Yeah, and Cliff directs me in that show in Dr. Stone. I play Taiju in that. But yes. Oh my God, the energy it's got to take. And I'll hear Cliff post, some sessions when he was working on Bakugo, especially post battles. He's like, hey man, how's it going? I'm like, oh, whoa. And he never taught,
Yeah.
So I know he's giving it his all out there. I would love to swing at that, but don't envy the damage.
I'm screaming.
I don't know if you guys have noticed, but I did a little typecasting. and Cliff is included in that. You can see elements of each of the characters and each of the people. So they're all so great for their roles. I wouldn't want to take any of them away.
I would agree wholeheartedly.
Yeah.
All right, guys.
Plus, Momo's awesome.
Yeah. We love Momo. I've said it like 8 times. Guys, I'm so sad. We have to wrap this up. Aww. Did you guys have fun, though?
Yeah.
Get on your feet. Let's give them a round of applause. Everybody, get on your feet. Come
you
on. Here we go. You guys were awesome. Thank you so much. I love you guys so much.
Thanks, guys.
And you guys know just up the stairs. Thanks. And you guys are going to come back out later. So we're saying bye, but it's more like see you later. You know what I mean? Okay. Justin Briner, Colleen Clinkenbeard, Kellen Goff, Ricco Fajardo, and Justin Cook, y'all. Wasn't that cool? I was shaking. I was like, oh my God, they're so awesome. Okay, but we know why y'all are here. We told you guys that you guys get to see some of the first episodes, right? I'm not gonna make you guys scream. Let's watch it. Let's do it, folks!
Yeah.
this is the end, y'all. It's a wrap. Thank you guys so much. You were a fantastic audience. And do not forget to check out the Funimation panel tomorrow at the booth. One last time, y'all. Go beyond.